Everybody. Ooh, welcome, welcome, welcome.
This is on really low.
Welcome. If you came in today and you noticed something different about the front of the church, your eyes are not deceiving you. The pointing and the masonry work has been completed, and the painting has been completed. There's a fresh new look out there. So if you didn't happen to see it when you come in, take a notice on your way out. And in that vein, I'd like to recognize John Pettigrew. Not only that he arranged all that to be done, but he has some words to say this morning.
That wasn't that true. I just want everybody to know what's going on, okay, and what our expanded church work so far and what we brought in. If the painting isn't finished, he's coming back and putting a second coat on.
Well, it's really good now.
Yeah, it does, but it's a huge difference. Huge difference. We did run into a situation with the lights on the new building here. There's three of them on two sides and the back. I had no continuity on the timer, and I checked the incoming power, and we're tripping brakes. Okay, so the ballast blew out on one of these lights. So my friend the electrician, he's going to change these two from incandescent to LEDs.
Okay.
And they will be taken care of. Right now we have two lights. The first light went to the bar, we found out that's where the short was, so he put wire nuts on that so he could use these two here. So there are some, but that'll be fixed tomorrow. Great. So far, the capital campaign, including the bathroom, the hallway, the painting, and the painter's bill is not in yet. The masonry is. And the deposit for the front awning is on here. So far, total expenses are $12,128.37. Thank you, Jim, for that. So what we brought in from contributions, we're right now in the red so far. It's $1,443.37. But we will be getting at least a $3,500 bill for painting. And then the remainder for the awnings. That's where we're at right now. But there's all the lights out there, and it makes a huge difference at night when you go past it. I think it looks great. It'll look really nice when the awnings on. That's it. I just wanted everybody to know where we're at.
Good job, John.
Thank you.
Excellent news. Also, I want to lift up our Deacons fundraisers that are coming up. Our soup and chili sale is coming up. And yes, it's the day after the libraries, but ours are better. And much more variety.
Amen.
Yes. We will do it the same way. For those that are providing the soup and chili, we're going to receive it cold here, so it'll be packaged in containers, and you can see Judy or any deacon to get containers for that. And then pasta and rice is held out separately in bags, and you can see her for that too. Also, the following fundraiser will be the RGA Cain's Memorial Christmas Cookie Bake Sale. It is a different week. It's December 13th now, Saturday, December 13th. We'll need bakers and providers for that, as well as people that can work for that. There will be sign-ups in the back, if there aren't already, but probably for the soup sale there are now. So, and we need those people. Please sign up if you can help, or if you can provide soup, or if you want to buy tickets. Speaking of tickets, coming up in 2 weeks, weekends at the Kingsbury Lodge of the Masons in Oliphant, they're doing their annual roast beef dinner sale. It's takeout only, And we can see John DePrimo, who is not here at the moment, for tickets, but they're all going to be, as soon as they're sold out, so we can see him for tickets, and if you don't have his phone number, it's on the poster that's on the back table now. So see John about that. We like to support the good work that they do as well. Later this afternoon, if you had not already heard that Dorothy Minnelli has passed this week, and we are going to have a service of celebration of life for Dorothy. Here, the calling hours will be 2 to 4, and the service itself will be at 4 o'clock. Everything's being held here, but it's being arranged by Decker's Funeral Home. So if you'd like to visit with the family, come between 2 and 4, and then the service will start at 4 o'clock. Yes, John.
There's one other thing I forgot to let everybody know. We have no outside water source for contractors who come to work on the building, and also for our great deacons who do the outside windows, okay?
Right.
So I'm working on that. I have a plumber from the university, a friend of mine. He's going to come and put an outside hose bid in. So that way we don't have to worry about somebody running down here to let contractors into the building for water source, like the cleaning brushes.
Judy?
Speaking of the cleaning of the windows, it's going to occur Saturday at 10 o'clock. We're going to do that, and we could use some help.
So cleaning of the windows is arranged, and you know, we built a church in the woods, so they get dirty a lot, and we have a parking lot that isn't paved, so we get all that dirt too. And we have very friendly bugs that assist on building nests and things around here, so. We continue to knock them down inside and clean the windows on the outside. It's just like here. Are there announcements that I missed? Oh, I know one. Next Sunday was to be our session meeting for October. A number of principals can't make next Sunday and the week after that, so we're going to cancel our October session meeting, try to contain your disappointment, and we'll just have one in November, and so that might make it a little easier for those that are being ordained and installed today, that you don't have to come right back and be here even though you've already been doing your work. That was the other announcement, is that we will have our ordination and installation service later. Are there other announcements?
Deacons meeting the 27th of October, the last Sunday.
Deacons meeting the 27th, last Sunday, and they've changed that to the last Sunday because we keep changing the session meeting.
Yes.
And so we're living up to our reputation for that too. But we just canceled it this time. Other announcements. How about some joys? I know we have a couple of joys. Linda.
Somebody celebrated a birthday on Friday.
Oh, somebody! It's initials are Doris Joyati. Wonderful. Are there other birthdays to celebrate? Then this is for you. Happy birthday. Celebrations today. I know there's one. Do you want to announce Millie's?
Oh yeah. welcome joy from Millie. I don't know if she knows I'm going to tell on her, but her great niece had a baby girl, so she has a new great great niece named Hunter Willow. So congratulations.
And it's sort of a joy, but it's also a sadness, is that with Dorothy Minnelli's funeral this afternoon, her daughter is Lindsay Schimmelfennig, and her daughter's daughter, Autumn, is one that we've baptized here. Autumn is now enrolled in the preschool here in the front, so... yeah, the connections of family are very nice, and this will be a bittersweet reunion, I'm sure, for everybody this afternoon. Other joys? How about times of prayer concerns? Anybody want to lift up any in particular? Yes, Janice.
Two.
Yeah.
The family of Ruthie Gunther Towers, the Towers family.
Ruthie Gunther Towers.
And the McEwen family, Tom McEwen.
And Tom Andrews.
My daughter-in-law's father passed away.
All right. Thank you. Others. Judy.
June Rovinsky.
Rovinsky? My neighbors. Others today. And of course, we want to lift up all the victims of Hurricane Helene, who's just destroyed whole communities in several states.
Nashville.
And Nashville. You'll be hearing about Asheville a little bit later in the service too. And then let's focus our hearts and minds on the worship of God this morning with our prayer.
Thank you.
The banquet table is prepared, and God calls us to feast together.
We have come
from east and west,
from north and south,
to sit together at the Lord's table. Compassion, love, and grace pour out like fine wine. God's word is bread for our journey. So let's join Christians around the world to share in God's gifts. Let us taste and see that the Lord is good. Let us worship the Lord our God. Please join me in our prayer of adoration. Almighty God, we cannot help but wonder indeed that you, who have created all we can see and all that we cannot even imagine and have called it all good, can be mindful of us mortals and given us power to help you manage the world you so love. As we gather in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray that you will open our lips to let our mouths declare your praise. Open our eyes that we might behold your presence in the world around us. Open our ears so that we can hear your call. And open our hearts so that we respond to the love you have for us. Amen. Our opening hymn is page 625.
Sings my soul, my Savior. joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
week I was at a workshop with co-workers, and it was about working in collaboration. The workshop leader said that he once started a meeting by listing all his shortcomings, and he was startled to see that everyone's head was nodding as he enumerated them. He realized everybody knows. He also knew that it was important for them to see that he realized he wasn't perfect. And just as we really can't hide our shortcomings from God, who must be nodding his head as we confess, it's still an important part of our faith development to do it. God knows the trials of humanity because Christ chose to set aside the glories of heaven to become human. Jesus walked the earth with all its beauty and tragedy. He experienced the joy of human relationships and the heartbreak of the brokenness of the world and suffered himself. So we know that we can trust that God, who knows us, longs to be known by us. So emboldened by God's love, we can be honest in confession, assured already of God's grace. So let us confess together. We'll leave some time at the end for a silent reflection. Merciful God, who are we humans that you pay attention to us? And yet you have entrusted us to care for all of creation. We confess the times we have thought too highly of ourselves and the ways we have twisted our charge to care for creation into permission to dominate and subdue it. We confess the same human tendencies to dominate and subdue other people. It is easy for us to ignore or take for granted our own privilege rather than seeking to dismantle unjust systems of supremacy. Your desire is for peace, but so often we choose comfort and call it peace. Remind us who we are and whose we are. Free us from the burdens we carry, so that we may be a source of peace in this troubled world. Set our hearts and minds on your will, made known to us in Jesus Christ, who is our peace, and in whose name we pray. Amen. So here's the good news. Because our Savior left the luxuries of heaven for a time to participate in this messy, beautiful world, we've been made siblings with him. Scripture tells us that the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all children of God. Jesus is not ashamed to call us beloved siblings, family. Because of his sacrifice of forgiveness and invitation, we can start fresh today and every day. May we live into the new day, assured that we are forgiven and renewed through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
We are forgiven.
We are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
We are forgiven.
We are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsive reading is Psalm 8, and that's on page 427. The hymn in the Pew Bible. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Stand if we're able, and we'll say together the things that we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth upon the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
God's love for us unites us as family. So let's turn and greet our brothers and sisters in the faith with a sign of God's peace and grace. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join your hearts with mine to pray for understanding of a rather difficult piece. God of wisdom, though we are mere mortals, you are mindful of us. You know the voices inside and out that distract us. You know the words we need to hear. By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with the openness of a child, so that we might better understand your intentions for our lives. Amen. Our gospel reading is from Mark chapter 10, verses 2 to 16. And you can follow along on page 822. Some Pharisees came to Jesus and to test him. They asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? And Jesus answered them, what did Moses command you? They replied, well, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. And for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife. The two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. And then in the house, the disciples ask him again about this matter. And he said to them, well, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. Then people began bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them and bless them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, and he laid his hands on them and blessed them. And then we have a reading from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And then we skip over to chapter 2, verses 5 through 12, and that starts on 970. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now, God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels. But someone has testified somewhere, what are humans that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made for them a little lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them. But we do see Jesus, who was for a little while made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of his death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everybody. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. The word of the Lord. I have to admit, the gospel passage for today stung a little. Jesus equated divorce with adultery, not only for the one who initiates the divorce, but also the one who did not. As a divorced person who did not see it coming or want it, it felt very harsh. It seems archaic in light of contemporary times when for the past 50 years or more, we've been hearing about half of all marriages fail. I was tempted to shorten the reading to just the part about letting the children come, because I wasn't sure how to address all the issues of divorce. And certainly everyone loves children. Hearing that part of the gospel makes us feel good. And isn't that what good news is supposed to do? So I am grateful for the commentaries that are available to access the scholarly research and thinking of contemporary theologians. And that helps me to shake the branches until the good news falls out. Feasting on the Word, Lectionary Lab Live, Working Preacher, Connection, and Pulpit Fiction are my reliable resources to go every week. The two Bubbas and a Bible from Lectionary Lab were very helpful in me understanding the context and the application of it. Synagogue leaders had been hounding Jesus, finding fault with his practices, trying to trap him with impossible questions. Jesus always was able to answer with honesty and wisdom that cut through the attempted snares. Today's question about divorce actually stemmed from a political context. John the Baptist had recently been beheaded. He was arrested because he rebuked King Herod Antipas for divorcing and then unlawfully wedding Herodias, his brother's wife. The palace was offended by his criticism and felt threatened when his preaching started to spread among the subjects. This put Jesus in a tough spot, to side with John and cause more trouble between the Romans and the Jews, or to decide against such morals. Or decide with the morals. It seems that Jesus always went to the heart of the matter, to God's purposes rather than the letter of the law. God's purpose for humans is to be in relationships that are healthy and mutually beneficial. God's intention was for community and relationship with him. Law was created as a roadmap for a happy life, not a dividing line for excluding others. In response, Jesus noted that the legal provisions for divorce were necessitated due to human brokenness when humans, in their arrogance, decided to live apart from their relationship with God and broke relationships with each other. It served to protect people who were being left to just not be, cast out and abandoned, but there had to be a certificate, and there were some provisions. God's perfect intentions for our abundant life together from the beginning was about good relationships that support, care, and love one another. Marriages usually start with good intentions, but something happens. Human self-centeredness damages relationships when one or both parties focus on grass that might be greener elsewhere instead of tending to their own gardens. So Moses had to find a way to mitigate the damage that was done to the spouses, especially wives, when the husbands decided to divorce, establish a legal way for them to go their separate ways when the relationship was broken beyond repair. But Jesus wasn't really talking about marriages at all, but about fairness, about relationships, and brokenness. Fairness because in the ancient world, women were considered to be property to the father and then the husband. Children were at the bottom of the hierarchy. The law provided for the man to divorce, but not the woman. The law about adultery was more about the injustice to the other man whose wife was having an affair with another man. Not necessarily to the wife if it was turned the other way. The segue from teaching about equalizing the effects of divorce to Jesus embracing a child connects the focus of this teaching. When some of the parents brought their children to Jesus to be blessed, children were just not a priority. They had nothing to give. They didn't know theology. Maybe they knew their 10 commandments, but they weren't seen as people allowed to interrupt Jesus' teaching time. So Jesus continued teaching, taking the child as an object lesson. Disciples must learn to see themselves as children to understand anything about heaven. He exhorted the disciples to not only include the children, but to learn from them about how they were to consider themselves and ourselves before God. There are a lot of positive characteristics about children that we usually think about. Such positive traits only remind me of W.C. Fields' thoughts about child actors. We tend to paint them on the backdrop. Children, like all humans, are a mixed bag. Loving, but they can be spiteful. Obedient, but can be mischievous. Finding loopholes where they can. They grow from being totally dependent infants through the terrible twos, tyrannical threes, obnoxious fours, and terrifying teens, as they realize they can experience the world as separate human beings from their parents. But children, especially in ancient times, were legally and in practical ways powerless. They were not able to negotiate their own contracts with nothing to bring to the table, nothing to offer in exchange for their food, shelter, clothing, or education. Good parents provide these things out of love and a matter of course. And we are loved and cared for by God, not because of anything we can give in exchange, impoverished and powerless as we are, but because of God's love for us. Ever since Adam and Eve were expelled from Eden, humanity has had to navigate tension between selfish desires with a strong sense of self-determination with living a full life in God's grace, in loving relationship with each other, with God. We aren't able to manage this abundant life on our own. We fall short of God's intentions for us. We admit this in worship every time we meet to clear the way to truly hear God's word for us. As a parent, God provides for our nourishment and growth, guiding us into maturity for the eternal life of the kingdom. And part of his parenting is providing remedies with that brokenness interferes with our growth. So God sent law, the prophets, kings who sometimes did and sometimes didn't lead the people right. And then God sent his good intentions for us in the human form of his own son, Jesus. Jesus himself is the remedy, the repair for the damage that is done by humanity's headstrong ways. The Hebrews passage helps us to unpack this. The author addresses that the world seems broken. Sin happens, it corrupts and disorganizes things, and life can be very confusing. And Hebrews was written as a sermon for second generation Christians removed from the intensity, intimacy, and passion of the earliest years. Seductive pressures of a materialistic and violent world were bearing down on them from every side. Expectations for abundant life felt out of sync with the culture they lived in. Sounds a little familiar. They felt burned out, discouraged, weary of serving, apathetic, unable to muster either discipline or delight that daily discipleship is supposed to offer us. They suffered from a spiritual chronic fatigue syndrome. Hebrews was written to reignite a tired faith, reminding us of God's amazing grace that was imprinted in Jesus, who was uncorrupted by the world. Jesus is the visible impression of the very reality of a God who loves us and simply wants us to be family together. The fact is, a power that sustains us to stand fast in faith, to live according to God's intentions for us. Hebrews confirms that Jesus, though made a little lower than the angels for the time he was human, emerged from his suffering and death as a power above the angels who cares for us and advocates for us. That same grace is imprinted in our own souls as well. As we suffer and endure and experience joy, God's power shines in our lives also. God speaks to us through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection so that we can navigate the world and continue to grow into the image that God planted in us, perfected through God's faith, through our faith in God's promises. Not perfect in the sense that we are on our own without fail, but in the sense of being completed for the purpose for which we were formed. As we connect closer and closer to God through the Holy Spirit. Whenever our souls, whatever our souls are meant to experience and learn from, are completed through the work God accomplished through Jesus. Scripture reminds us that the world is broken in many ways. But we see Jesus, and our hopes for the world and ourselves are renewed. Today, we exhibit our hope as we ordain and install deacons and elders to empower us to do the work of healing together. And today, we experience communion, just as people around the world have experienced it or are now or will experience. John Calvin said that in communion, God does not come down to us, but the Holy Spirit raises us up to be with that cloud of witnesses, along with all the angels and the hierarchy, to join in the eternal hymn of praise, which is truly God's intentions for us. So, let us enter into our special services of ordination and installation and communion with the expectations of children, just as we are, with nothing to bring to the table except ourselves, prayerfully and playfully, knowing we are loved, grateful to be included, and simply happy to be in God's presence and all with all the beings who adore him. Amen.
We lifted up Asheville earlier today in our prayer concerns. And Asheville is the focus of what I wanted to say for the minute for mission for the peace and global witness, special offering that we take for these next few weeks. Asheville, North Carolina, if you have not been there, is a gorgeous community. It's a small city. It's nestled in the mountains, and it is nestled right alongside of two rivers. Those rivers, in a matter of hours, rose over their banks and virtually destroyed the city. If residents and business owners and shops and churches were lucky enough to be on the highlands, they probably sustained minor damage. But Asheville is the home of literally dozens of churches of all denominations and all faith traditions. Big ones, big mega churches, and little ones, small ones. And one of them is the First Presbyterian Church of Asheville. And it's a little bit larger than ours, membership-wise, but looks similar, although it's a traditional style church building. Sanctuary is similar in size to ours. Let me just share with you what the associate pastor David Germer said. In the wake of Hurricane Helene, all regular church activities and services are canceled. But they did not stop being a church. They immediately went into service mode. The First Presbyterian Church of Asheville has a very vibrant youth group, adult choir, and Sunday school that is going very well. And several years back, they also started a child care center, which has now grown so big that has become a separate entity altogether, still in nonprofit status. So when they went into service mode, they stopped what they normally do in church and started helping the people in the area rebuild. They themselves sustained some trees down in the property, but they were high enough not to be flooded. So they moved into helping the flooded churches, communities, shop owners, peoples, children, school day services, feeding and getting clean water to them. Water is not usable there. The city-wide water is not usable there. And they decided that until further notice, they will be in service mode, just doing what people of God are supposed to do to help their neighbors and brothers and sisters. Also, I just wanted to read a little letter here. My name is Diane Rayfield. My husband Mark and I just moved to North Carolina 2 months ago, and we were delighted to find the First Presbyterian Church of Asheville. I am a retired pastor and a licensed therapist in California, but not here. So taking anything I say as friendly, but not professional advice. We have all been through a traumatic event. For many, the trauma is continuing. Recognize that none of us are functioning as well as we otherwise would be. Many of us can be brave and steady for days on end, but eventually all of us need to release stress somehow. Everyone reacts a little differently. But some of the symptoms of living in the midst of a crisis are these. Thinking you're doing fine and then bursting into tears for almost no reason. Sleeping way more than usual or not sleeping well at all. Wanting to eat much more than usual or having no appetite. Having a sense of free-floating anxiety. You have your basic needs covered, but you can't quite understand why you feel so anxious. And depression. Being more short-tempered than usual and getting angry at things that normally wouldn't bother you at all. And being desperate to control minor things because major things feel so out of control. All of these are normal responses to experiencing a traumatic event such as a hurricane. Some things you can do to help yourself are these. Get outside. Natural daylight has a big effect on regulating our physical and emotional systems. Dimly lit rooms feed depression. Take a walk. Physical exercise helps to rid your body of stress hormones. Cry when you feel like it. Stress hormones have been shown to exit the body through tears. Help somebody else. Neighbors pooling resources solves practical problems, but also lifts moods when you know you helped another person. Establish routines. So much of what we do normally do is different now. Eating, sleeping, and exercising at regular times helps. Talk to other people, share your stories. Talking about how it was for you can relieve some of the stress. Now that stores have reopened a bit, try to eat meals that are healthy and feel as normal to you as possible. And come to church. Many of us using the internet and charging here in church and recharging, so there are people to talk to every day. Peace, Diane. With the Peace and Global Witness, we get to keep a part of it. And we can have a conversation on where we're going to use that. Are we going to split it, use it all here? Or are we going to pick a project out in the community? Or are we going to partner with one of our other Presbyterian brothers and sisters who maybe can't access that help right now? These are choices we can make. And if doing so we want to help the Asheville Presbyterian Church continue its child ministry and helping and feeding the community as we do here. We can make those determinations in a bit of time. When session meets back, we will probably decide on where we want to send the funds that we receive through this special collection. But keep in mind that Asheville is just my suggestion, and you may have some others yourself.
Gracious God, we thank you for entrusting us to participate in your worldwide circle of caring. May the offering of our time, talent, and treasure that you have sown in us bring you joy and bring our neighbors comfort and hope. Show us how to use these gifts entrusted to us for your glory and your dreams. Amen. Now we'll move to a service of our ordination and installation.
There are different gifts, but it's the same Spirit who gives them. There are different ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. God works through different people in different ways, but it is the same God who achieves his purpose through them all. Each is given a gift by the Spirit to use for the common good. Together we are the body of Christ, individually members. And though we have different gifts, together we are a ministry of reconciliation led by our risen Christ. We work and pray to make his church useful in the world. We call women and men to faith, so that in the end every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Within our common ministry, some members are chosen for a particular work as ministers, ruling elders, and deacons. In ordination, we recognize these special ministries, remembering that our Lord Jesus said, "Whoever among you wants to be great must become servant of all, just as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free."
Madam Moderator, speaking for the people of this church, I bring Mary Beth Hopkins Rooney to be ordained and installed as deacon, and Dory and Linda Troiani to be ordained and installed as ruling elders. I also bring John Primo, Sharon Gaffredo, Janice Jackson, and Darla Spearsan to be installed to a new term as deacons, and myself, Tim Norton, to be installed to a new term as ruling elder.
So God has called you all by the voice of the church to serve Jesus Christ in a special way. You know who we are, what we believe, and the work for which you've been chosen. Understanding that whatever successes we achieve in our lives can only be accomplished with the help of God. So please answer these questions, and I'll prompt you how you should answer them. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you?
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ and the Church Universal and God's Word to you? Do you?
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic, reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people? Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
I will.
And will you be governed by our church's polity? And will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
I will.
Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you?
I do.
And will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love?
Will you?
I will.
This is for the deacons. Will you be faithful deacons, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? And for the elders, will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in the councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
And now for the congregation. Do we, the members of the church, accept these witnesses as deacons and ruling elders, chosen by God, the voice of this congregation, to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we? Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? Do we?
We do.
And now we invite any ordained deacon and elder from any time to come forward and lay hands on our newly ordained elders and deacons.
And then
we'll circle around,
we'll
lay hands.
And you do not have to kneel.
Very not much. Most of the church.
Uh-huh. We're laying our hands on the ordained.
On the ordained.
And
the
Lord. And the Lord.
We're all connected here.
Yeah, that's the way. Feel the power. Please join me in prayer. Almighty and gracious God, in every age you have chosen servants to speak your word and lead your people. And we thank you for these witnesses whom you have called to serve you. Give them special gifts to do their special work. Fill them with the Holy Spirit so each may have the same mind that is in Christ Jesus. Be faithful disciples their whole life long. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. For friends and colleagues of faith, you are now deacons and elders in the church. And for this congregation,
thank you.
Whenever you do a murder deed, you are
Let's join together singing a very appropriate song for this occasion for both our ordination and installation as well as our communion, page 69.
across the globe as we gather around the table. Christ's table is set. It's set for all. Around it, there are no divisions. Just as one loaf is made from many grains, and as one cup is filled with the fruit of many grapes, so we, though many, are made one in Christ, nourished by Him to nourish the world. Jesus calls us to this table, and all are welcome here. We come as children, nothing to give except ourselves. We come to our Lord's Supper to reaffirm our commitment to the vows of our baptism. So let's taste and see that the Lord is good. Please join me in our prayer of great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us lift up our hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is our greatest calling and joy to give you thanks and praise, Lord God, Creator of heaven and earth. You spoke, and all things came into being. Your Spirit swept over creation and brought order out of chaos, life from the formless void. From the elements of the earth, you created humankind, each unique, all made in your holy image. Your breath gave us life and called us to live with you in loving service to neighbor and stranger alike. Yet when we turned away from you, you never turned from us. Through the prophets, you called us back to your ways. You sent Jesus, your Son, born of a mother's flesh, to reveal the full extent of your grace and love. Again and again, you welcome us to your side with the open arms of a loving Father. Therefore, we join our voices with those from every time and around the world to proclaim your glory and unending.
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God in power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest.
Holy is your Son, Jesus, O God, walking this earth, feeding the hungry, calling the lost and lonely. He brought healing and wisdom to those who sought him out. His life revealed your kingdom, taking shape in our world. As we break bread and share wine in his name with your people here and in every place, we recall the mystery of our faith.
Christ was born so that we might see hope in the flesh. Christ lives so that we might hear grace spoken aloud. Christ died so that we might understand the way of life. Christ was raised so that we might know his promises are true. Christ will come again so we might be blessed as God's children.
Pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine as we remember Jesus poured out for our sakes. Gather your church together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom, where peace and justice are realized, and joy will be shared at the banquet you prepare for us, when heaven and earth join hands. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, tender and mighty God, our Father, now and forever. Amen. On that night, like no other, never to be forgotten, when our Lord was arrested, he was at table with his disciples. He took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, me again in prayer, and we will, when we get to the people in our bulletin, say their first names together out loud. We'll continue keeping the board on the list. Majestic and eternal God, you have fed us with the bread of life and satisfied us with the cup of salvation. As we rise from the table, may we remember our connection to our siblings in Christ around the world. Make us instruments of your peace, messengers of your love in thought, word, and deed. Lord, we hear groaning for relief of earthquakes, all the people billowing with fire, rage, and wind, and wild storms and floods. We pray especially today for all those in the aftermath of Hurricane Helene, especially the city of Asheville, and raise our sisters in Christ at the First Presbyterian Church, that they'll be strengthened for the mission and service that they are about. We ask you to send your comfort, O God, to those longing for relief from the ravages of climate and change and natural disasters. And though our own abilities are limited, we trust you to send your spirit to stir healing and fresh hope and to equip us to respond as you would have us do. Today we are especially mindful of friends and family who are in need of the healing and the comfort of your presence. And we pray especially for those concerns raised in worship, for the family of Ruth Powers and Tom McEwen, for June Rubinsky, for healing for Jim, and as always, we pray for those in our bulletin who have asked us to pray for them. Dick,
Dolores and Herb, Russell, Kathleen, Liz, Alex, Jimmy, Tom, Jeannie, Bill, Karen, John, Steve, Sue, and Sandy, Janet, Alice, Mary Lou, and Anna John, Jim, Charles, John, Frank, Carol, Judy, Carly, Kevin, Jim, Alberta, Denise, Maria, Jenny, Lori, Bonnie, Suzette, Chuck, Lisa, Bill, Cole, Janice, Tina, Carrie, Marge, Charles, Albert, Francis, Keith, Rudy, Megan, Greg, Patrick, James, Tom, Marilyn, Joyce, Jonathan, Linda, Patty, George, Julie, Melanie, Charles, Wade, Rosemary, Dave, Jimena, Marianne, Marion, Muriel, Rick, Sheldon, Joanne, Kathy, Stanley, Jamie, Bonnie, Rebecca, Alan, Jean, Pearl, Darlene, Lily, Dawn, Heidi, Judy, Rosie, Meredith, Nancy, Leo, Brian, Jack, Bruce, Teresa, Jack, Christopher, Sue, Tom,
and also family and friends of Joanne's kin. Lord, we are thankful for this congregation, for all who are here today, and also for our elders and deacons who have been ordained and installed to lead our people in ministry. We are grateful that you have nourished us, body and soul. We are grateful for all of the joys that you send our way as well, for Dory's birthday and the blessing that he is to those around him and his witness of faith. Lord, we know that we appreciate that all the gifts that you have given this congregation, and we pray for the window cleaners, soup makers, and Christmas cookie bakers, and that we pray that you will tap them on the shoulder to step up and share We're grateful for New York, for welcoming Hunter Willow, and pray for her family, for Alexandra and Danny and Big Sister Wren. We're grateful for the work and for this building, all the work that John has done to coordinate all of the work to make this place beautiful and safe. Lord, we are grateful for the sunshine on our face and the walks by the river, the sounds of the birds that speak to us and cheer our hearts. We have heard your love proclaimed, and now we know that you will send us out to speak it to others who have seen your love poured out. Now send us out to show it in everything we do. We pray all of this in the name of the one who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Closing hymn is page 525.
Time again to scatter wherever God sends us until we gather again. So let's go, holding God's steadfast love before our eyes, for we can see Jesus. Beloved children all, carrying the blessing of family that we have received as children who share what they have with all of God's children. And may God who made us, and Christ who mends us, and the Spirit who brings us life, bless us and keep us forevermore. Amen.